Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Waterford High School for this evening's first selectman debate. My name is Brett Arnold, and I am a civics teacher here at Waterford High School. And during the springtime, we had an opportunity to work with the League of Women Voters. And they came in and they did a voter registration drive with us, and they also sponsored an essay contest. And one of our students actually won that essay contest and had the opportunity to travel up to the state capitol and be introduced before the state legislature. Well, as that relationship started to develop between Waterford High School and the League of Women Voters, the idea was conceived to have a debate between the first selectman candidates. And I personally would like to thank the League of Women Voters for being willing to come into my classes during the school day and work with my students in researching the issues and developing questions that are going to be used for this evening's debate, along with some of the questions that were contributed to through when you were walking in this evening. So, with that being said, I'd like to thank both of the candidates. They came into school today at 9:30, and they did a debate for almost 100 of our students here at Waterford High School. I thought it was a really well-run one. I know I'm impartial because I work here, but I thought the students did a wonderful job. They served as moderators, and they served as timers for the debate. And we do have one young lady from my class here this evening, Miss Teresa Price, who will be serving as one of the moderators today with Mr. Chenier from the day. So with that being said, I'd like to thank you all very much for coming out for this evening's debate, and I hope you have a worthwhile experience. And again, thank you very much to both of the candidates for coming in doing their second debate today. So with that being said, I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Price.
Good evening and welcome to the Waterford High School First Selectman Debate. Tonight's debate is sponsored by Waterford High School, the League of Women Voters, and the Day newspaper. I would ask that you turn off or silence all cell phones at this time and refrain from applause during the debate. Each candidate is given a total of 25 minutes in which to respond to questions and raise a rebuttal. Timers will indicate the amount of time remaining for each candidate. Applause will count towards a candidate's cumulative time. Speaking tonight for the Republican Party is incumbent Dan Stewart seeking a fifth term. He will be opposed by Democratic candidate Peter Davis. Each candidate will now have one minute to give an opening statement.
I'm Paul Shawnee with the Day newspaper. Welcome tonight. And by a flip of the coin, we determined that Mr. Stewart would have the first opening statement. Mr. Stewart.
Well, good evening, and thank you to the Day, League of Women Voters, Chamber of Commerce, and the school itself for allowing us to do this debate tonight. I've been the first selectman here, and I've been privileged to do that for the last 10 years. It's been an exciting role, and we've had a lot of change and a lot of activity in that period of time. My family moved to Waterford in 1880, so we've been here a very long time. We had the privilege of growing up in a wonderful community here in Waterford. Kathy and I raised our four daughters here. Three still live here, and we have every interest in keeping them here as long as we possibly can. I have seven grandchildren that we enjoy very, very much. They're a very special part of our life. And when I look at what Waterford has done and where I've gotten perspective in this from Waterford, I served on the RTM. I served on the PTO for Cohansey. I served on the Board of Education. So I've had a lot of experience, and this brought a lot of information to me, and it made my life a better place, so I know Waterford can be a better place through what we do tonight.
Our time is up, Dave. So just to make sure our candidates, our timekeepers are right in front of us, and they will give you prompts. So next, Mr. Davis.
Good evening. I also want to thank the League of Women Voters, and especially the students from the civics class at the high school and the Day paper for giving us this opportunity to talk to the community directly about some of the issues and some of our opinions and perhaps solutions to solve some of the challenges that we're facing over the next few years. I was lucky enough to be born and raised in this town in a family that honored community service and it was instilled in me at quite an early age, in my middle 20s actually, that it made sense to give back to the community to try to make it a better place. So if I have to give you one reason specifically as to why I'm running, it's really just a commitment to that public service and community service. I've served on the Board of Selectmen, the RTM, the Board of Finance, and the Conservation Commission. I was actually chair for 5 years. I served there 7 years in total. So again, this is a furthering my commitment to the community, and I appreciate you all being here tonight.
Mr. Stewart, regarding the staffing at the firehouses in Goshen and Quaker Hill, how do you reassure the citizens in those fire districts they are safe and will get the same coverage as other districts?
The fire districts have coverage in all five firehouses. The three center firehouses have two full-time paid firemen for every shift during the week. The Goshen and Quaker Hill firehouses have a full-time, full shift paid firefighter that is not a full-time firefighter. I have to rephrase that. I apologize. They're a part-time firefighter who works a full shift on those days and fills those shifts. The other question that you asked is, how do we measure that? We measure that based on calls, based on shifts filled, and we've had no shifts missed and no calls missed.
And Mr. Davis?
Yeah, I have a different opinion of that. First of all, what we tried to do when the issue first came to light is we tried to take a step back and look at it objectively, and we've tried to do that through the entire campaign and look to the record and actually do some basic analysis so we can formulate an opinion on some of these issues. What we found was that after the contract was ratified in December, it was kind of a surprise to a lot of people, including a lot of elected officials in town, when they learned that there was actually going to be a reduction in coverage at Quaker Hill and Goshen Firehouse. That reduction in coverage is actually a reduction in man hours for the paid men. Before the contract was ratified, the paid men were working 10-hour shifts. Now they work 8-hour shifts, and they're assigned through the fire administrator's office. If you do the math, what we found was that created a shortage of man hours with the paid men in the firehouses of about 500 hours in Quaker Hill and Goshen Firehouse. So there is actually a reduction in service if you simply do the math. Now the idea was, in an attempt to be fair about it, the idea was is that those shifts that were potentially uncovered would be covered by volunteers, again assigned through the fire administrator's office. Trying to be objective about it and give it a fair run, what we hear is happening is that paid men are coming off an 8-hour shift in another firehouse, taking 8-hour shifts in Goshen or Quaker Hill, and then going back on another 8-hour shift. So essentially they're, for all intents and purposes, within 24 hours, they're working three shifts and trying to squeeze in some sleep and family time. I don't know that that's a safe situation in the long run. The fire administrator did admit publicly that there would be times when potentially the firehouses in Goshen and Quaker Hill would actually be empty. Nobody would be available to take calls. Fire calls are one issue. My primary concern is with that lack of coverage or reduction in coverage on the emergency services side with the ambulances. 2 or 3 minutes on a medical call is a significant amount of time. If you're having a heart attack or you're having a stroke or you have some other serious medical problem, it's imperative that people get there as quickly as they can. And the fact that there may be a gap in service that would result in a longer response time in those instances, quite honestly, is just not acceptable to me.
Mr. Stewart, he covered a lot of territory there. Essentially, he does not feel this is well organized and firefighters are forced to overwork. So we'd like to hear your rebuttal. You have that opportunity.
Certainly. The firefighters have been much in favor of this program. And a number of the comments as far as meeting these calls, what we've done is we really are looking at the EMT calls or the ambulance calls. And those ambulance calls, we've had a number of occasions where the call would go to first to one of the outlying stations, happens to be Goshen. That call would be toned out at Goshen. They couldn't get a crew, and a crew from Jordan made the call. And they made the call in a short period of time, and it was done correctly. As a matter of fact, the two vehicles met at the site. We have not had an issue with missing a call or missing any of the parameters around these calls, and that's part of what we watch every day to make sure that these calls are being done safely and the firefighters are protected as well as the residents. Thank you.
if briefly you want to say anything more on that before we move to another question?
No, we can move to another question.
And that next question goes to you, Mr. Davis. You have made much of the fact of your long experience as a planner in the city of Norwich. Yet Norwich has a very high tax rate and continues to have a struggling downtown. So is that really a record of accomplishment that you feel would make you a good first selectman here in Waterford?
I've heard this attempt to make a comparison between Waterford and Norwich throughout the campaign, and I quite honestly think it's apples and oranges. The fact of the matter is that, to my knowledge, I haven't held an elected position in Norwich over the past 25 years. And the fact of the matter is, and Dan knows this also, that the issues of setting mill rates and budgets and providing services is a direct result of the elected officials and them doing their job. The city of Norwich is an old mill town. There are a lot of them throughout New England. They're suffering the legacy of a lot of properties that quite honestly don't perform as well as they should financially. It's a city with a population of 40,000 people. They've got a fairly high poverty rate. Approximately 50% of the students that attend elementary school there are eligible for free lunches. So to compare Norwich in that respect to Waterford, I take issue with that. I think, in fact, based on the population and some of the challenges that Norwich has faced over the past decade, including basically absorbing all the impacts from the two casinos, that I think they've done a relatively good job. The fact of the matter is, Norwich's bond rating is the same as Waterford's. So if you consider what Norwich and other urban environments struggle with day to day, and the fact that they've been able to maintain and, in fact, get a slight increase in their bond rating over the past 10 years, speaks to the management and speaks well to the way that the elected officials in Norwich have tried to wrestle and deal with some of the challenges. I guess if Norwich was lucky enough to have a millstone power plant years ago, we might be having a different discussion tonight.
Thank you. Mr. Stewart, did you want to comment on that question?
Well, I think a lot of the situation between Norwich and Waterford are very different. You're absolutely correct. Waterford is an economic development environment. We've had a great deal of economic development come to Waterford. If you look at Charter Oak Credit Union, you can see Coca-Cola, FW Webb. We've had a great experience of bringing in new businesses. Great Neck Country Club is a good example where we were asked to buy it as a town. We chose not to. I did talk to Norwich about their golf course, and one of the issues that we have is the golf course up there is a financial neutral environment. And that's a difficult environment when you're doing economic development. By having the golf course here owned privately, we actually get tax revenue from that. And tax revenue is what I think is important to the community so that we don't have to charge the taxpayers more for every event that we go to. So I believe that the economic development in Waterford is more the issue that I feel we are strong in. And that's really where I would leave it, Paul.
All right, thank you. And the next question goes to Mr. Stewart. Your opponent has contended that there is a common theme between some of the issues your administration had and in criticism it's faced concerning the development of Seaside, the changes with the fire coverage and the animal shelter discussion, and that's a lack of communication. So I'd like to hear your reaction if that is a fair criticism. And what do you do to make sure you communicate with these constituencies sufficiently?
Communication is a big issue in all communities. There's a very difficult process to get information out. And one of those problems that the town of Waterford has experienced is a lack of a day reporter. We've had a number of different reporters come to us, and they've gone away, partly because they didn't feel there was any media reasonably there, and they didn't use it. The other part was we had a website that was basically non-interactive. Currently, we have put a new website in place that is interactive, and we're able to communicate much better. All of the meetings that we held within the animal control and the other item that you mentioned, not the firefighters. We're all public meetings, which are open to the public and are very poorly attended, but they are open to the public, and that's where the information is given. On the firefighters, because it was negotiations, it was done in closed doors, but that's negotiations, and that's how that's done. That's personnel matter.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. The issue of communication?
Yes. From my 20-plus years, actually including my time on the Conservation Commission in Waterford, it's approaching 37 years now, which I hesitate to admit sometimes, but the fact of the matter is that public participation and the value of that to government is ingrained in my soul. I facilitated, I don't know, probably hundreds of public meetings and public hearings during my professional career. And in my mind, it's the foundation of government in this country is the idea that the public is allowed to participate essentially at any level if they're invited in to participate. The issue of communication going forward, Glenn and I actually, it'll be on our website tomorrow morning. Glenn and I have basically created a work plan for our, if we're lucky enough to win this, for our first year in office. That work plan is an agenda for Glenn and I, and it contains, I think, 27 different action items that we intend to move forward. Right at the top of the list is the issue of communication. Because in our going door-to-door and in conversations with people in this community, that's one of the things that's been a consistent point or bone of contention with people is the issue of public access and not feeling like they, even when they did attend meetings, that their opinions or their feelings were valued. So right at the top of our list, the first thing we're going to do, the selectman meetings for a number of years now have been held at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, I don't know about you folks, but 5 o'clock in the afternoon, if I want to attend a meeting in Town Hall, if you've got a family, if you've got a job, 5 o'clock doesn't really work out. When I was on the Board of Selectmen with Mr. Eckerd, we had our meetings at 7 o'clock in the evening. That affords people an opportunity to get home from work, have dinner with their family, do what they need to do, relax a little bit, and then they, if they're interested in an agenda item, they can actually come out to a meeting. The other thing we intend to do is we're actually going to add to the agenda a public comment period. We are going to make it a point to invite public comment at selectmen's meetings. I think it's an obligation on the part of Glenn and I, again, if we're lucky enough to get elected. If we're standing here today being critical of process in the town of Waterford, specific to the public's ability to be engaged in government, we need to take it upon ourselves and hold ourselves accountable to change that. So that's what we're going to do. Those are two of the items. There are some other issues. In the interest of time, I think I'll yield the floor.
Did you want to respond to any of that, Mr. Stewart, before we move on to another question?
And just two things. One is there's always public comment allowed in any meeting, and we always open that door if there are people there that want to publicly comment. And we've had that in our meetings on a regular basis. The fact that we have them at 5 o'clock or at 7 o'clock, the attendance is still the same because the Board of Finance is still a 7 o'clock meeting and the attendance is still not there. Thank you.
Just quickly, for me, it's not an issue of attendance. It's an issue of having the public know that they have that opportunity and it's there. And I think having meetings at 7 o'clock in the evening, whether they're well attended or not, I don't care if it's one person, two person, 20 people. They need to know that they have the opportunity to come and speak at a time that's convenient for them, not for me.
We'd like to check how much time each candidate has remaining.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Concerning local transportation, how would you work with our state legislators to ensure that those who travel on I-95, Route 11, and Route 85 are safe?
We actually had that question this morning with a student debate. Very good question. There's a lot of discussion in Hartford and locally and regionally about what to do with that 95 corridor, and regionally that folds over to Route 85 and Route 82. It's You're kind of in between a rock and a hard place. If you take a look at transportation planning studies, basically where you have situations where highways are at capacity, there is a school of thought that will tell you that because we're a vehicle-oriented society, that if you build more capacity into the roads, eventually you're just going to end up with the same traffic congestion you have today. So I think, from my perspective, I think it's a public policy issue, not only in Hartford, but across this country. I think anything we can do to encourage mass transit, especially in New England, there's just this parochial attitude that we can't deal with mass transportation. At some point in time, we're going to have to deal with that issue, because the cost of even just that I-95 project, if you're paying attention to the papers, budgets are severely limited. The idea that we'd spend all our resources on that I-95 corridor when we have other concerns is a bit disconcerting to me.
Thank you. And Mr. Stewart?
The state government has indicated that they want to widen the highway. 20 years ago, they also said they were going to widen the highway from New York to Rhode Island. Unfortunately, that stopped in Saybrook. And if you come on a Sunday afternoon and try to go to New Haven on 95, it's simply not available. The widening of 95 would be very beneficial to the safety of our traveling public that is mostly a pass-through traveling. But we do need to get that resolved so that we can have better access to the area to travel. Mass transit is obviously an alternative. We've been working with Southeastern Area Transit for many, many years trying to improve that service and make it better for our communities. As you know, in Waterford, there's a couple of routes they come through, but they're very limited, and the attendance or the ridership on them is relatively low. We would like to see that improved, but again, it's a challenging venue to get more people to ride the bus. They're very happy to drive their own cars. And that's really where we become problematic in this whole thing. When you talk about 85 and Route 11, those are very big numbers of dollars to make those happen. What we do need to do is make Route 85 safe. That's a bigger issue, and that's something the state can address very quickly if they're willing to. And my job, and what I've chosen to do, is work with our state senator and state representative to push those issues with the Department of Transportation. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Davis, would you like to respond?
No, I'd rather go to another question.
Mr. Stewart, how would you work with the superintendent of schools to make sure the new school buildings are maintained for future generations?
We've invested a great deal in these schools. If you've had the opportunity to see them, these are truly magnificent buildings that we have in Waterford at this point in time. We meet with the superintendent, the assistant superintendent, the building and grounds people on a regular basis. We are doing everything we can to maintain these buildings as they are today. It is certainly a challenge. These are huge buildings. There's a lot of square footage here, and we have a staff that does that for us within the Board of Education. As far as my role in that, I work with the superintendent because we utilize the Board of Ed services for building maintenance. So it's a combined effort on our part and the Board of Education, and the superintendent is very much aware of what we're doing and how we're doing this, and we've had very good discussions. We also work with the IT department on a shared basis. It's not just the Board of Ed or the town. We all work together to try and get these buildings taken care of. And by all means, these are complicated buildings. They're very sophisticated, and we're very pleased with the fact that they are working and they are taking care of our children. And one of the things I like to say is we have the best buildings and we have the best staff that educates our children. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Davis?
One of the issues that Glenn and I have been talking about for some months now are capital planning issues in town. And our position has been that there really hasn't been any serious attempt to do any capital planning since October of 2011. And that's based on what we found in the record. The issue with the schools is an interesting one. Some years ago, the Board of Education actually used to control their own capital plan. There's been a change, and the capital responsibilities for the Board of Education are now included in general government. That requires a much higher level of communication. Excuse me. Back about almost 2 years ago, There were some minutes of the Long Range Financial Planning Committee, and they had scheduled a meeting, and the purpose for the meeting was that there was concern on the part of the Board of Finance and the RTM that even after Quaker Hill had been built new and put online about 5 years ago, the other schools were being constructed and we were into the high school project, just starting it. The fact of the matter is there wasn't any money in the capital budget to address capital needs for the new schools. And there's very little in the budget now. The results of that meeting were the people were supposed to go away from that Board of Finance meeting and come back with ideas to address not only the capital needs of the schools, but there were concerns about there being no plan in place to address the other capital needs in other buildings in the town. To date, there are no formal, strategic, pragmatic processes or plans in place to address those issues. That's something that Glenn and I have been very critical of, quite honestly. And we have some items in our plan to actually address those issues going forward.
Thank you. And Mr. Stewart, would you like to respond?
Certainly. We do have a great deal of capital planning that's gone on over the past few years. In the past 10 years, we've actually spent over $40 million on capital building plans and works that we've done within the town of Waterford. That includes roads, that includes buildings, that includes a whole lot of things. We do have a plan going forward to resolve the four buildings that we're really concerned about, that being youth services, town hall, police station, and public works. Those four are absolutely in the plan and are concluded in our capital plan, which is a five-year outlook. We do have those plans going forward, and we do believe that we can meet those plans in the next few years without increasing the taxes.
I do want to respond to this one. Part of my responsibilities as the director of planning in Norwich for a number of years now has been facilitating the capital plans for the city of Norwich. Without diving too deep into the weeds, what you need to understand is that what Dan's referring to is a capital plan in the town of Waterford, in my opinion, is basically a list of projects, and they have dollar numbers assigned to them. It's been demonstrated over the past year or so, as far as we can determine from the record, that a lot of those numbers are significantly off. Those projects have been deferred, some of them, for 10 years. The fact of the matter is that some of the projects that Dan's talking about being in the plan and being ready to go, they're not going to be on the drawing board for another year. Plans actually have to involve not just a laundry list of projects and some dollar numbers thrown at them. There actually have to be action items created. There has to be accountability driven into it. There have to be time schedules. And those dollars have to be programmed out because you've got other capital needs and responsibilities as you go along. So simply to put them in a laundry list isn't by any stretch of the imagination a plan. It's simply a list of things to do, similar to what you do on your own house. The fact of the matter is that we are very, very much behind on the effort of doing real capital planning and programming the funds going forward to take care of these capital needs. And again, Glenn and I have some plans to address that.
I'm fine. Okay, maybe we can get an update on the times. Mr. Stewart, you have 17 minutes left. Mr. Davis, only 12 minutes, so you might keep that in mind, or your opponent will have a little extra time there. Next question goes to Mr. Davis, and it's sort of a follow-up to the discussion we were just having, and you've been critical of the incumbent for a lack of road work, a lack of progress on repairing the public works facilities, and you point to that lacks planning, but what would be your philosophy in balancing infrastructure needs against the need to try to control taxes, because as the first selectman points out, you know, he's also had to finance these school constructions.
Going forward, and Dan has alluded to it, we have these other capital projects to take care of. So here's the issue, and I'm going to make it short, believe it or not. The issue becomes how you manage that going forward, because whether it's under the current administration or a new administration, the fact of the matter is we have these capital issues that we need to take care of. So the issue for me is simply this. It's going to be a matter of managing that. And I think what you need to do is it starts with a conversation, and you need to prioritize and figure out how to do these things. It can be a combination of different things. You need to have that discussion. It could be short-term binding. It could be long-term binding. It could be some revenue driven into it. So I think where you start with that is a conversation and get back to the type of logical planning that was done back when, quite honestly, back when I was on the Board of Selectmen in 2004.
Mr. Stewart?
Well, it would be interesting to do the planning again and go back and look at what was done between 99, 2005, and from 2005 to 2015. In a 2005 to 2015 period of time, we've done 31 roads, 5 pump stations, and we've repaired a number of our buildings. In the 5 years, 6 years prior to that, we did 8 roads. I don't have the other details, but that's the difference in what we've done with our infrastructure. And in doing so, we've managed that with the loss of $20 million of revenue that was coming in from Millstone based on the deregulation. So we had to balance our budget with a $20 million loss of revenue that was extremely difficult to do, yet we managed it. And we managed the process, which is how we managed to keep our taxes at a realistic level with all the difficulties. The school building project was very expensive, and that is something that falls into our capital plan. But our capital plan, as I mentioned earlier, we've spent in the 10 years that I've been here over $40 million on roads, pump stations, and the buildings. That's what we've done to maintain our infrastructure, and we need to go forward doing a few more things and continue that process of not financially breaking the bank.
Just Mr. Davis, yeah, would you financially break the bank with your ideas?
No. Dan knows that question or that statement is ridiculous as I do. The fact of the matter is that under the form of government we have, if I were going to drive this town off the fiscal cliff, so to speak, I'd have to rent a bus, because you've got 3 people on the Board of Selectmen, you've got 7 people on the Board of Finance, you've got 22 people on the RTM. They all have a say in what happens. So again, I find it hard to believe that those 30-some-odd people would say, yeah, that's a great idea. Let's jump the mill rate to, 40 or whatever. Pick a number. The form of government we have, there are checks and balances. Those are in place for a reason. I don't, by any stretch of the imagination, think that the Board of Finance or RTM is going to let me drive us off the cliff.
Anything further, Mr. Stewart?
Certainly, I would agree with him. The boards and the committees are the people that keep us sane. So thank you.
All right, thank you. Next question goes to Mr. Stewart, and it concerns a bond proposal you brought to the Board of Finance that was just mentioned. It's one of the checks and balances you have here in Waterford. It was a 12.9 million dollar package, and it was voted down. I was wondering whether were any lessons learned from that rejection, and what have you done in the meantime to address some of the issues that would have been addressed by that spending proposal?
Thank you. There were a number of issues included in that. We had bundled some things together under the finance director's advice at that point in time. We had worked to do a number of different projects, and the Board of Finance was not pleased that they were bundled together. That's one of the problems we had. We took them apart after that, once they rejected it, which was their option. We took the bundle apart. We are now in the process of doing the windows at Youth Services. We're putting the bids out for the windows at Town Hall, which were also included in that. And those financing packages have been approved. We have the process of bidding those so that we can get the best work done in the springtime. So they'll be bid over the winter and done over in the springtime. Those two projects were the two major ones. The HVAC system is the third one that'll have to be done afterwards, but it has to be engineered after the windows are completed. To do it any other way is like, you can't do it all at once. The bonding package was intended to provide the funding to do that. Because the Board of Finance chose not to approve it, we took it back, revisited it, and went back to the Board of Finance and asked them to help us do that.
They have done that as we went along, and it was approved by the RTM to do the smaller projects. The other project that was included was the Public Works facility. And the Public Works facility is due to be brought back to the Board of Finance in the next couple of months. That's their plan to bring it forward. And then we will go forward with that, and we'll go again through the process of going to the Board of Selectmen, Board of Finance, and the RTM if we get that far.
Thank you. Mr. Davis?
There are a few other a few other issues that the Board of Finance wasn't entirely happy with when that bond proposal was put forth. One of the other issues was there were, within the scope of the project to be bonded long-term, were things like landscaping, painting trim, pointing up brick, basic maintenance items included in a bond proposal that you'd pay interest on for 20 years. Those are basic maintenance issues that you do out of operating revenue. Those aren't things that you bond for 20 years. Essentially, you're putting that on a credit card. One of the other issues the Board of Finance had is, as they went through the numbers, it was confusing as to whether we were going to pay for this long-term bonding or out of a steep grant that had been submitted to the state of Connecticut. I had actually asked that question, and to date, I still don't have an answer. But the fact of the matter is the town did not get that grant. When they were going through the grant application and they were going through the backup material for the projects to be bonded, there were a couple members on the Board of Finance that pointed out to the first selectman that the numbers in the grant application didn't match the numbers in the bond proposal. So, an issue of maybe not paying attention to detail. But the fact of the matter is there were other items in that bond proposal that we had no business bonding long term, things you just don't put on a credit card.
Mr. Stewart, in particular, the point there were things in there that should have been normal capital projects in your regular budget.
Normally, I would agree. The pieces that he mentions truly aren't part of the bonding per se. But then again, when we do the high school and the schools, they were all included in the school building projects. How they get financed is a different issue, and that's part of what you have to figure out. I would say that one of the things we do deal with is the Board of Finance has a liaison. It sits at every meeting. In the case of the Board of Selectmen, we asked the liaison when we first presented this, what questions do you have? Can you help us? Can you give us guidance? I'll ask the questions when I get to the meeting. So we didn't get guidance, and that's one of the reasons that there was some difficulty there. It's unfortunate. It went forward. We will continue to move it forward as we go on.
A brief response, if you're not the opportunity. If not, we'll move on to the next question.
Mr. Davis, what are your feelings towards a regional animal facility and how will it affect Waterford?
What I'd ask you to do, because of in the interest of time, is to go to our website. We took a position on the process involved in this project early on. So again, I'd ask you to go to the website and read that if you're interested. But here's what I think is the critical issue. And for me, it's simply this. I tried to take a step back and look at exactly what this project was supposed to be. And if you think about it, basically what we're doing with this animal control facility, potentially, is we're entering into a long-term financial agreement with the state of Connecticut, potentially, to fund and operate this facility. So again, taking a step back. My history back when I was on the RTM and the Board of Finance and the Board of Selectmen, they had this thing way back when. It was MER, minimum education requirement. I think that's referred to as education cost sharing now. What that was simply was a formula within the state of Connecticut that reimbursed municipalities a portion based on a formula for education. They never have honored that. They've not met their obligation. Things like LOSIP programs, pilot funding. Pilot funding is payment in lieu of taxes. Towns that host state facilities are paid a payment every year because of the loss of tax revenue. LOSIP is local capital improvement plans. That's usually used for bridges, roads, water, sewer, those kind of things. They've continually reduced that level of funding, and as state budgets tighten up, I would expect that they would be reduced even further. Just a few weeks ago, the state of Connecticut reduced the town's pilot payment by 50%. So essentially halfway through our budget cycle, or not quite halfway through our budget cycle, the town of Waterford takes $150,000-some-odd hit. My point is this. If you're objective about it and you realize that you're potentially entering into a long-term financial agreement with the state of Connecticut, and this commentary applies to all administrations, again, this goes back 30 years, maybe a little bit further, The state of Connecticut has got an absolutely horrible record as far as meeting their obligations, financial obligations to towns on a number of different fronts. If you're paying attention to what's going on in Hartford, they're going to be cutting and cutting and cutting more. So I'm not comfortable, if my job is to protect the interests of the community, I'm not comfortable entering into that sort of a long-term financial relationship with the state of Connecticut when they can't even find $150,000+ to make us whole on our pilot payments. So for that reason, and that reason alone, I don't think it's a smart step on the part of the town to enter into that agreement.
In defense of what the town has done with this, there are a number of issues with the state as far as what they're doing. One of the other things that the state is doing is proposing regionalization, and regionalization without any alternatives. So regionalization is something Waterford has done with East Lyme and the animal shelter for many, many years. That, and it goes back, I would say, almost 50 years that we've been regionalized in this environment. To regionalize with another community can help us, and that's where we have been talking to Montville as well. And that would be something that would be beneficial to us. Involving the state is absolutely an issue that has to be well drafted, well written, and maintained to be sure that we're going to get full stature of what we expect. Anything less than that is certainly a challenge. And we have the issue of a challenge with them. There are no documents associated with this at this point. It's simply a handshake environment where we are going to look at this and try to do this, and we have to get further information from the state to see where are they going, are they willing to support this or not, and then we can go forward with whatever ends up there. But truly, the state is a challenging environment in today's world. The $150,000 in revenue that we planned on will hurt, and we have to find a way to make that money up. Thank you.
And one final thought. The fact that the state can't live up to their contractual obligations, I don't know that I'm willing to do business with them on a handshake.
Right. Can we get a time check for the next question? Mr. Stewart, you have 12 minutes. Mr. Davis, you have 6.5. So, a question from the audience regarding Seaside. Mr. Stewart, is there any chance that under your leadership, you would be willing to file a lawsuit against the state for its actions to claim Seaside as a state park?
The state of Connecticut, to sue the state of Connecticut, you have to have their permission. That's not something I would ever entertain. The legal costs that we've incurred associated with Seaside are enough. The state has chosen to make it a state park. They've also talked to us about the potential of doing some kind of an inn or some other alternative quasi-public environment down there. If they would do something of that sort, where there would be an environment down there that would draw people in and utilize the facility in a way that those properties could be used, that would be very beneficial to the town. It would be very beneficial in a lot of ways to the community in that area. It's not something that a park or everything, which was the proposal, somewhere in the middle there might be a happy ground, and that's where the quasi-potential, quasi-public, private environment could be utilized to manage Seaside and make it a better environment. They always had, in every proposal, public access to the waterfront was always included. And that's an important aspect because this is a beautiful piece of property. And right now, the buildings are in disrepair. Again, this is a function of the state property. They have not managed their property well. And that's unfortunate because these are beautiful buildings that 10 years ago probably could have been saved. Today, they're going to have a hard time doing that. But in my eyes, yes, a quasi-public-private partnership would have been a nice alternative, and the DEEP is still looking at that.
Thank you. Mr. Davis?
Would I consider suing the state? No.
That's a way to save some of your time, Mr. Davis.
Exactly.
So the next question, exploring Seaside a little more. Mr. Stewart supported a plan. It was sort of on and off. that would have had a private developer developing those buildings into housing, condos, and keeping public access to the waterfront. You say you would have supported a park from the start, that you feel it should be a park. But given the state's resources, shouldn't it be a concern, and how would you address that concern, that they may do a very minimal effort there at that facility, and you know, we might have the worst of both worlds, really no development much at all, you know, and yet, you know, the public going there. So, you know, how do you try to control the future, you know, of Seaside, given it is a state property at this point?
Yeah, it is a difficult situation. Once the state took it over, local zoning doesn't apply. So the state essentially, not that they can do whatever they want, I would hope that they would be sensitive to the neighborhood and the town, whatever the end result is. But having dealt with the state of Connecticut and the portion of the former Norwich State Hospital property in Norwich over the years, Norwich and Preston, I absolutely have concerns. I'm going to be completely honest with you. I have no faith, based on what appears to be going on with the state budgets going forward, that they're going to be able to follow through. I think as administrations and agendas shift in Hartford over the next few years, and their track record with maintaining existing parks, I'm not confident that that's going to become a priority. I think it's well-intentioned, but I do have concerns about them following through.
Mr. Stewart, on the future of Seaside?
I believe that the future of Seaside is in the hands of the state at the moment. I'm not sure. Now, it's been taken back by the state before, and then they put it back on the market again. It's been one of those up and downs that we've had to deal with. I am concerned if you make it a pure park, similar to Rocky Neck or Harkness, you're going to have a traffic concern. You're going to have other issues that will associate with it. A park is a wonderful asset, and open space is a wonderful asset, but sometimes that can be misused by our public, and we don't really want to see that misuse. We want to see it used as a park, as an appropriate facility. If the state would allow them to do some things, the state has that option. The state could resell it. They could reopen it again. All of those things could happen, but it's dependent on the state. I know the state has had a shortage of workers to actually be down there to help clean it and to take care of the property. And taking care of that property is what we really care about. It's a beautiful piece of property. As I said, you've got waterfront down there, but it has to be made safe and secure for the public to be there. And that's really what it's all about.
Anything further before we move to the next questions? Okay, why don't we do the time? We're kind of winding down towards the end, see where we are. So Stewart, 9 minutes, and 5 minutes for Mr. Davis. Mr. Stewart, the next question involves climate change and the fact that you govern a coastal community, and you know, the question is, what steps have you done to help prepare and have Waterford deal with the effects of climate change, and what will you plan on doing going forward if reelected?
We've been working with the Nature Conservancy to try and determine how to rebuild and make our coastline more resilient to the weather storms. With the storms of Sandy and Irene, it obviously gave us a heads up as far as we need to be careful. These properties are very sensitive. When you look at our beach property at Waterford Beach, the dunes got wiped out by Sandy. We had to rebuild them. And it's all about putting this all back together. So we saw this, and we went to the Conservancy to say, how can we make this better? And they're willing to help us do that. And they're giving us guidance now through our planning department. And that's really where we're going to go with the climate control. We are well aware that the water levels are rising. We've seen that. We have some indication to that effect. We are a waterfront town. We also have an awfully lot of wet environments. That's why our Conservation Commission is as strong as it is. If you go anywhere in Waterford, you're apt to find a piece of wetlands, and those have to be protected in all cases.
Mr. Davis?
I don't think there's any doubt that we're in a cycle of more severe weather. You can turn on the TV every day, and between the fires out on the West Coast and what's been happening down south, not even with hurricanes, but with torrential rains they've had. So I think going forward, the best thing to do is obviously to remain vigilant, make sure that your emergency plans are up to snuff, and to the extent that you can, even though it's difficult because human nature is human nature, you have to do what you can to protect life and property. So again, I think that's just an issue of managing that potential hazard, and I think quite honestly that the folks that are responsible for that in the town of Waterford do a heck of a good job.
Mr. Stewart, what do you have to say to people who say it's time for a change in leadership in Waterford?
The biggest issue I would indicate to that is, what change do you want? And if you want change, my door is always open. I'm always welcoming people. Tell me what you want to change and what's not going the way you want it in Waterford, and how can we make it better for you? And I've always said that my door is open. People come to me. Some people don't, but that's okay. I'm willing to listen, and I'm willing to work with the public, and that's really the message that I would want to give out there. Let me know what you want, and we will find a way to attempt and try to make it better for our community. The door is open, and that's where I would have to go and ask, what change do you want, and is our direction not the right direction today? Then tell me what is.
I think what it boils down to for me is a difference in management style and taking a look at some of the challenges that we have ahead of us. Our position has been for a number of months now that there's been a lack of planning in the town of Waterford to prepare us for challenges going forward. You use downtimes to do planning so that as you come out and things start to turn around, you're prepared to take advantage of that upturn. We haven't seen that happening, and again, that's based on the record. I think we need to get back to some aggressive, proactive planning exercises, and if nothing else, I think that allows the community to know what's going on. Right now, if you were to walk into town hall and you asked for a strategic economic development plan, they don't have one. If you were to ask for a real capital plan, they don't have one. So I think to better prepare us for the future, and the reason we think that there needs to be change is that, quite honestly, I think through our life's work, Mr. Patterson and I have the skill set, we have the abilities, we have the desire to make sure that we get back to that type of planning. Our feeling is, quite honestly, it hasn't occurred for whatever reason, and we need to change that. You know, to use Dan's words in the paper this week, he said publicly that he won't go out and he won't battle for things. I think the fact of the matter is that now that we've lost the revenue from Millstone, the step-down process is over. We've got an unreliable climate, even more unreliable financial climate when you take a look at the state of Connecticut. I think you need leadership now that's going to be a little bit more aggressive. And if there's a community issue or a community something that's going to set the community back, my feeling is you need somebody that's going to be a little bit more aggressive and is going to push the community's agenda. Having said that, I just think we need to switch things up a little bit and get back to what we used to do, and we need to be a lot more aggressive going forward, because whether we like it or not, with the loss of Millstone revenue, we're playing on the same level field as everybody else now. So we have to be better prepared going forward.
Stewart, do you want to respond?
Certainly. One of the things that I think we are better prepared for is the economic development stream, and that's where we've been able to build our community up. Being aggressive and being a leader doesn't require me to be a planner. It requires me to be a leader and to make decisions, which we have done. Those decisions people may question at times. That's part of why you make decisions, because there's two sides to every story. I try to get both sides so I can be as correct as possible. I will make decisions. I do lead.
We have been through two planners since Mr. Wagner left. I'm sorry, we're not through two. We have our second planner. And we're very excited about that person who's bringing a lot to the table. That's a new study for us. Mr. Wagner was here for 30 years. Tom did a great job for the town of Waterford. And to change that now has been a challenge. We are seeing that challenge, and we're meeting it, and we're going to go forward with it. So that's really where we are.
Mr. Davis, what specific qualifications do you have that makes you a better candidate than someone who has held this position for 10 years?
I think what I alluded to in the beginning is I've got 37 years of municipal experience, not only in Waterford, but in an urban environment in the city of Norwich that sees a much more diverse set of issues and problems than Waterford has over the years. So I think that that has quite honestly been a free education for me and has prepared me a little bit better, I think, to take care of issues going forward.
Mr. Stewart, do you wish to respond?
Certainly. For the 37 years prior to myself becoming the first selectman, I worked in a variety of different roles, working for the telephone company and Dominion, getting a better feel of how to manage people, how to manage issues, and how to effectively run a business. Those tools were given to us. The phone company was probably the best teacher of how to be a manager in a variety of different situations, and they would put you in all the different situations. Being a publicly run company, because the phone company was under the guidance of the PUCA at that point in time, we had to be responsible to the public in many, many different ways than what you would as a municipality. A municipality is a very different form of government, a very different form of a business, but it is a business. We have income and we have expenses. They both have to be managed and they have to be managed well. We feel that in the past 10 years and with Rob Brule and Paul Suprin, we've been able to do that in our role. And I don't mean to leave Paul Constantakis out of that, but we've had the opportunity to work through those issues, work through the Board of Finance and the RTM to get those things done for the town of Waterford. In my eyes, that's where I come in to be a stronger manager. I am a leader in that role. Rob Brule is who I'm running with. He's a leader as well. I believe that that's where we can go forward and do a better job for the town of Waterford and leave it a better place than what we found it.
Can we see the times before we kind of move on to our last question or two? 4 minutes, Mr. Stewart and Mr. Davis, you are down to 2 minutes, so we're a little closer than we were, and that works out because the next question to you, Mr. Stewart, and this came up in our student debate today, when Waterford welcomed Millstone Station, the agreement with the federal government was the federal government that the nuclear waste, the radioactive nuclear waste, would only be stored at the facility for a short time and then would be taken for a safe to a safe depository by the federal government. As we know, the federal government has not lived up to its side of the bargain, and now we're seeing those spent nuclear fuel rods stored in CACs at the facility. So my question is, has Waterford done enough to make it clear this is unacceptable? And you know, what steps have you taken working with our congressional delegation to try to make the federal government live up to its obligation to remove that nuclear waste?
The federal government, when they established the nuclear power plant process and the facilities within the country, promised everyone who was located and had one located in their community that they would take care of the waste. And that was the federal government's promise. Obviously, they have not lived up to it, as Mr. Chenier says, and that's true. We do have the storage out there. We are concerned about that storage on a regular basis. We meet on a weekly basis with people from Millstone. We meet with our emergency management people, and I meet with Representative Courtney. I've met with Senator Blumenthal. We have an issue with it. When we take it to them, they have not been able to put this through the legislature to get this resolved at a high level, because this is a federal level, not a state or local level. But we meet with Millstone. How are they being taken care of? Are they safe? Are they being treated properly? All of the issues that are associated with any kind of fuel at Millstone because of the concern of danger of it, we address. And we've been addressing that for the last 10 years that we've had this storage out there. And my prior history at Millstone gives me an understanding of how it works. And they don't want it there any more than we want it there. But they are also challenged because they're going through their government representatives to get that done. And that includes the people in Virginia, who is the Dominion, comes from Virginia. That's the ownership of that plant. They are also fighting for it, as are the 101 other nuclear power plants in this country. They're all in need of it. The other point would be, in years ago, there was an opportunity to rehabilitate nuclear fuel and reuse it. The United States government, under President Carter at the time, determined that that was not a function that he would support, and it was a law made that would not allow them to rehabilitate fuel. If you go overseas to Europe, you'll find that's exactly what they do, and that's why they don't have nuclear waste. For our opportunity to do that, we would have to have some legislation done, and we've asked them to investigate that. They have not done it. So we are, unfortunately, home to a nuclear storage facility that we aren't real happy about, but we have it, so.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. Mr. Davis, and particularly the issue, would you be in favor of reprocessing nuclear fuel, since that was pointed out by Mr. Stewart?
Yes.
And what would be your approach to try to, Waterford's approach, if you want to comment any further, on trying to get, you're a Democrat, the president and the Democrats change the rules so we're not taking it to Yucca Mountain. What would you do as first selectman to try to advocate for Waterford on this issue?
This is just not a Waterford issue. This is a perfect example of a colossal failure of national policy, quite honestly. I think going forward, every opportunity that we can take locally to ensure that the federal government lives up to their obligation for the disposal of that material properly and safely, we need to stay on top of that.
All right, imagine we don't have a lot of time left. Check that. All right, you'll have 2 minutes on what will be our last question, Mr. Stewart, and you'll have 49. So
it works.
Fairly close. One of our questions from our audience wants to know whether the candidates are in favor of aggressively removing all invasive plant species in our that are a problem in some of our waterways. If not, why not? And I think the question begins with Mr. Davis.
The short answer is yes. The state of Connecticut has put legislation in place that allows local municipalities to work on taking care of invasive species, plant or animal. The issue becomes how you structure that and if you have the capacity to enforce it. So I think going forward that, in my opinion, what we need to do is clarify who's responsible for that enforcement responsibility, because I don't think we've done that in town yet. In fact, I don't think we're enforcing it. So going forward, we need to be cognizant of that and actually determine who's going to be responsible for it.
And Mr. Stewart.
The invasive species, unfortunately, Waterford is an area where we have an awfully lot of wetlands, as I've mentioned earlier. We do work on those invasive species. One of the biggest things we have are some of the animals that actually impact that as well, and they will plug up areas. I would agree that we need to find a way to do that. Enforcing those would be a difficult process in finding out who would be ultimately responsible. And the state law right now does not put responsibility on any party. And it does create an awkward position for all of us because we know we have issues where these plants are growing and we need to get them resolved. So it is awkward to say the least.
Thank you. And I think we're going to be moving on to final statements.
Mr. Stewart, if you'd like to give your closing statement first.
Certainly. In closing, I'd like to thank everyone for coming out this evening, and I'd like to thank our sponsors in the high school for this event. Public office is not a position that can be considered lightly. and the public needs to see who we are. As the first selectman and town manager of Waterford, I have to provide strong leadership in the financial and the physical environment that we have in Waterford. Our finances are strong, and we continue to have great success with our new economic developments. And our town does not need to elect someone who will be learning on the job. I have a plan in place and an excellent track record, which will continue fiscal prudence, maintains our infrastructure, promotes the best educational environment for our children, ensures our bond rating, and supports our senior population, all without inappropriately raising our taxes. My goal is to continue the plan of economic development and make Waterford a better place for all of us to raise our families and enjoy time. Thank you.
Mr. Davis, your closing statement.
I also want to thank everybody for their attendance and their attention tonight. This has been a valuable experience for me also. Elections are about the future, and I think we're in a position now that where we've had long-range plans that were put in place over a number of years, actually going back to 1999 when the first issue of deregulation raised its head. We had a number of long-range plans in place, and they were there for the very specific reason of keeping us out of the situation that we're in now. We have a number of capital projects that have been deferred for a decade. Costs have risen significantly. So I think actually it creates a false sense of financial security, if you will. The fact of the matter is that 10 years ago you had projects that were much more easy to manage financially than they are now. So again, it becomes an issue of management. I think going forward, again, because of the loss of tax revenue we're done with the step-down process, I think it's even more important to understand that you take care of these challenges by doing proper planning. I think Mr. Patterson and I are the more qualified team in that respect due to our life use. I think that we'll take a more aggressive and progressive approach to it. And I don't necessarily think this is learning on the job, because every selectman, when they're first elected, they're learning on the job.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Davis. That brings the end of our debate. Thank you for being a great audience. I'd like to thank particularly the student questioner, Teresa Price. I think she did a great job. Have a good night, everybody. Thank you.